إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صفيه وخليله، أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا. أما بعد، فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. عباد الله، إن الله تعالى يقول في كتابه العزيز: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. ويقول سبحانه وتعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. My dear brothers and sisters, we are living in the very special days that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them special for the big event that happens in the life of Muslims, and that is the pillar of Hajj. And it will happen in this month of Dhul-Hijjah. And the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah are special days. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged his followers to do more extra voluntary work to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from doing extra prayers, from fasting, from giving sadaqat and zakat, and visiting the family, and doing extra work, because the reward in these days is so great. That Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, even more than somebody who goes for jihad, he said, even than somebody who goes for jihad, unless he goes and he would have spent all he has and he would have died there as a martyr. But otherwise, these 10 days of the Hijjah are very special days. We are recommended to do extra da'wah, extra prayer and ibadat, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless us, and so that we may attain His pleasure and be among the successful on the Day of Judgment. The event of Al-Hajj, my dear brothers, is certainly a unique event in the life of human beings. There is nothing like it, where people would come from all over the world, from all corners of the world, going to one place, meeting in one place, doing similar things for a few days, all to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the humility, in the simplest form, leaving dunya behind them. Even the dress code will be changed for that occasion. You will not be allowed to wear your normal clothing. All you need is a piece of cloth to cover your body, and that's it. And if you wear anything else, it won't be accepted from you. And all people, they will stand in the same place on the day of Arafah, the day that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Hajj Arafah is the day where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will listen to the dua of His servants, and they will be blessed, they will be under His mercy. And it is recommended for the rest of us to fast that day, because it is a special day and the reward is so great. So these are important things to keep in mind, my dear brothers. A day of your life that goes will never come back, and you do not always have special days. Please, I advise myself and you to make you the best use of them. And that is about Hajj. And those, of course, some of you who have already probably are going to Hajj, we wish them all the best. Inshallah, they will have a safe journey and come back safe to their families. The other thing that I'd like to remind myself and you, my dear brothers, is the udhiyah, the sacrifice. The sacrifice which have become part of Sha'air al-Hajj, part of Muslims celebrating and remembering that occasion, is to sacrifice. It is the tradition of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The background to this story, it happened during the time of Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. Prophet Ibrahim, who exemplified the best of all men, who left his home to follow and fulfill the command of Allah, when he was told to go and rebuild the Kaaba. And while he was rebuilding it, when his son grew and became a young man, he saw in his dream that Allah is asking him to sacrifice his son. And then Ibrahim alayhi salam asked his son in a very kind way. He said, Ya bunayya, inni ara fil manami anni azbahuk, fanzur madha tara. A very gentle, very kind father. Obviously, you know the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam. He did not have children in his young years, and it was only at late years of his life that Allah blessed him with Ismail and Ishaq. And here is the only son, and I don't need to tell you how special and precious children to the parents and to the mothers and to the fathers. And here you are receiving a command from Allah to tell you to sacrifice your son. It's a great trial for the Prophet concerned, for that young man, how to deal with such a command. He said, Ya Bunayya, he said, Fanzur madha tara. So what do you think? He said, My son, I have seen in a dream, Allah is ordering me to sacrifice you. What do you think? Fanzur madha tara. And the reply of that young man, which I'd like the rest of the young men in this hall and elsewhere to behave with their parents with the same respect, with the same listen to the commands and suggestions and advice of your parents. He said, Ya Abati, if'al ma tu'umar. My father, do as you are told. Insha'Allah, I'll be patient. Satajiduniya insha'Allah min as-sabirin. I pray to Allah to help me to be patient, to submit to such an unusual order. It is something extraordinary for a young man to accept that his life is about to finish on the hands of his own father. It is something, it doesn't happen to everyone. And he said, My father, do as you are told. He knows his father is not joking. He knows that his father, his dream is a command, it is wahi. And So they went ahead. He prepared his son for the defined day, and he prepared the knife, and he brought him, and he put his face down, and he carried his knife about to fulfill the order. At that moment, Jibril alayhi salam appeared, and he brought him a big sheep, big lamb instead, and he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has accepted from you. You have achieved the purpose of the command. You fulfilled the order. You were about to do it, and you have succeeded. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instead have sent you this lamb to sacrifice. And from that day on, Muslims sacrifice on the Eid day a lamb or a big sheep or a cow or a camel. It depends on the size of the family. And it is a tradition that should be done in that spirit, commemorating the memory of Ibrahim alayhi salam, the great prophet, and his son. It is a total, what it signifies is total submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To submit, even if Allah tells you to sacrifice your son, you will do that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need the blood of anyone. And even the sheep we sacrifice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, its blood does not reach Allah, but what reaches Allah is the taqwa, is the intention, it's the sincerity, it's the fulfillment of the taqwa, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you greatly for it. And it is meant to be distributed and given to the poor, to the needy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it possible for all of you to fulfill such a great sha'ira, great sunnah, to follow the tradition of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers and sisters, the Muslims will be convening on the day of Hajj, and there'll be millions of Muslims, and they'll be coming from different parts of the world. And some of those parts of the world are not living normal life. They probably will be coming from Iraq, from Syria, from Palestine, and from elsewhere, from the places where it is hotspot, could be from Afghanistan. They are living tough times, yet some of them, they even go, even of all the circumstances that go against them, and they do the effort to fulfill the rukn, the fifth pillar of Islam, to do Hajj. May Allah help them, make it easy for them. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله والغفور الرحيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. My dear brothers, there are brothers standing outside. I'd like you to please move forward a little bit and fill the space in between. Make space for your brothers and sisters to join our congregation. My dear brothers, I referred slightly to the situation that is happening in the Muslim world today. And I think you agree with me, we are going through difficult times, through times that we have not seen before, where Muslim countries are burning, killing, destruction is happening in many Muslim countries. And it has become very tough for people to live normal life like you and me. It is in most of the cases, it is not of their choice, it's not of their planning, but they might find themselves in the middle of a situation that we do not wish it to anyone, let alone our brothers and sisters in Islam. from Somalia to Libya to the Middle East. It's burning. And the peoples are having a tough time. And that really made me think back in the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I found a story that I found relevant to our situation. And it is in Surah Al-Ahzab, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the event where the people, the Muslims in Medina, they faced a plan, a conspiracy to exterminate them and to finish them. And all those who share animosity to Islam, they got together. And they made a plan which really wasn't easy for Muslims. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described it well in Surah Al-Ahzab, where the mushriks of Quraysh and other Arab tribes were inspired, were encouraged by some Jews of Al-Madina, the Jews of who were went to Khaybar. So as a revenge against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they worked out a plan to exterminate the Muslim community and finish their existence in Medina. It was worked out plan that if it was allowed to fulfill its purpose, probably there wouldn't have been Islam in the world. But as in every situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there and He is on the side of the believers. We may not plan enough, we may not know everything, but we know that Allah will not let us to ourselves. If we depend on Him, He'll be on our side. Let me read you two ayat in this context. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in verse number 9, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. O you who believe, remember the favor of Allah upon you. إِذْ جَاءَتْكُمْ جُنُودٌ فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ رِيحًا وَجُنُودًا لَمْ تَرَوْهَا وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرًا. O you who believed, remember the favor of Allah upon you. When the armies came to attack you, and we sent upon them a wind, and armies of angels you did not see, and ever is Allah aware of what you are doing. And in verse 10, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذْ جَاءُوكُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِكُمْ وَمِنْ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ وَإِذْ زَاغَتِ الْأَبْصَارِ وَبَلَغَتِ الْقُلُوبُ الْحَنَاجِرِ وَتَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ الظُّنُونَ. And remember when they came to you from above you and from below you, and when your eyes shifted in fear and hearts reached the throats, and you assumed about Allah various assumptions. You thought that Allah had left you. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هُنَالِكَ ابْتُلِيَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَزُلْزِلُوا زِلْزَالًا شَدِيدًا. There the believers were truly tested and shaken with a severe shaking. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that when the armies from all over Arabia came to attack you, and He saved you by sending wind to destroy their camps and to make their life difficult, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved the believers. But Allah described that it was tough moments for the believers, that you were shaken with a great shaking. Yani, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the fear of believers, and they are humans like you and me, when you know you are surrounded and helpless, you think that that's it. But obviously this is where the difference, where people will be distinguished. There are those who have trust and faith in Allah, unshaken faith, but there are those who have weak iman, and there are the munafiqeen, who will even make it worse for the believers when they start spreading rumors and yani making the life difficult for believers. My dear brothers, if it wasn't for the ingenuity of Salman al-Farisi, who suggested to Muslims to dig a ditch around them to make it difficult for the armies to cross over to Muslims, it would have been probably a different situation. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped the Muslims. They dig out a ditch which prevented others reaching them, and they were saved. They were surrounded, my dear brothers, for a whole month. For a whole month. And it was tough moments. So tough moments, tough times, they happen. Even they happen during the lifetime of the best of the people. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his Sahaba. Those trials and tests, they purify the ranks of believers. And they will uncover the munafiqeen, those who have nifaq in their hearts, those who pretend to be believers. In convenient times and in difficult times, they show their true face. Al-munafiqeen, my dear brothers, nifaq and hypocrisy was a phenomena only happened when Muslims became dominant in Al-Madinah. In Quraysh, in Mecca, there was no munafiqeen. There was only kafirs, those disbelievers who were outright enemies, clear enemies. But in Medina, when the Muslims had the upper hand, there were those in Medina who did not like Islam and Muslims, but they could not do anything about it, so they pretended to be Muslims. They go to the mosque with Muslims. And by the way, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was informed about them. He knew them one by one. One day they even want to build a mosque, an alternative mosque to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's mosque. It's called Masjid Dirar. It is also mentioned in the Quran al-Kareem. So as to divide the ranks of believers, cause disruption. Anybody, my dear brothers, one advice I would give to my brothers and sisters in these confusing times, where there are some people who claim to be doing work in the name of Islam and in the name of Muslims, and they have nothing to do with Islam. Like that group which has become infamous for its brutality. The name is Daesh, and I spoke about it a few months ago in this mosque. And I said they are a danger to Islam and Muslims. And I said that I question whether they are really Muslims. And we came to know more facts about them. I personally did some research. And some of their leadership, my dear brothers, they are not even Muslims. One of them, his name is Umar al-Shishani. And I found out that his name is not Umar. And he is not from Shishan. His origin is from Georgia, and he is Christian. His family is still living today, and they are Christians. And he was in the Georgian army, and he was in the military. And when he retired from the army, somehow he found a job and he went to Syria. His parents described, we think he went for money there. His father saying, I know it's not really faith, it's money. We are poor here in Georgia. We have nothing. Who recruited him? Who find a job for him? Who is paying them? Who is arming them? Those are questions that need to be raised. My dear brothers, I'd like to say that we should not be fooled by names and titles. Judge people by their actions. Don't be fooled by the length of their beard. By the way, this Umar al-Shishani, his beard is this. And if you measure somebody's religiosity by the length of his beard, he is too religious for all of us. And there are other groups, God knows where they are. All we can say that they are not different to those mercenaries who were roaming in Africa and arranging coup d'etats, changing the situations, and in some situations they had more armies than some African nations. They are not different. Today, my dear brothers, the world, they cannot face Islam and attack it directly, so they use some proxy groups, some mercenaries to play the dirty game to give them an excuse. Otherwise, who is the real terrorist, my dear brothers? What do you kill of those who killed the people in Gaza? What do you describe them? Those who killed almost 3,000 men and women and children in daylight on television screens. Live people were witnessing the destruction, the killing of innocent people. A nation, I would call it a terrorist state, used everything they have to kill innocent people in their homes, in their schools, in their mosques. Isn't that terrorism? Why the world is quiet about the terrorist acts of this nation, of this state? Why now suddenly the world got united to fight Daesh? That is the claim. Some journalists, they went to the Syrians and they told them, how do you feel about this latest program of attacks against Daesh? They said, we believe the real terrorist to us Syrians is the regime. He's the one who's been killing us for the last 4 years. Why the world has done nothing to this regime? He is the one who used chemical weapons against us. He is the one who is destroying our lives. Daesh is just playing the regime's game. I said in the last khutbah a few months ago that Daesh never attacked the regime, but they kill other resistant groups. Is the world confused? Don't they know the fact, or what is it? Why do they want to give the impression that Islam is a violent religion? Do you know, my dear brothers and sisters, made me think back. Muslims have ruled the world for more than 1,000 years. Practically ruled the world for more than 1,000 years. Baghdad was the capital of the world for 900 years. And then for another 300 years, Istanbul was the capital of Muslims for 300 years. There are still Christians living in Iraq. There are still Yazidis living in Iraq. There are still Jews living in Iraq. For 900 years, for all more than 1,000 years, if Muslims, it was part of their belief to kill anyone who is different to them, they could have done it and nobody could have challenged them. But it is not part of our faith. It is not part of our religion. In our religion, we protect non-Muslims. We protect Ahlul Kitab. Those who live among us, we protect them. My dear brothers and sisters, the Inquisition, it didn't happen in the Muslim world. It happened in Spain. When Muslims lost rule in Andalusia, what did those forces, the Crusade forces? They killed Muslims. They destroyed their mosques. They wiped out their graves. If you go to Spain, you think Muslims, if it wasn't for some touristic sites left for tourists, you would think that Muslims have never lived in Spain for 800 years. And the Jews were killed also with Muslims. And do you know the Jews, where did they go when they fled from Spain? From the Europe of the Crusaders, from Christian Europe, they went to the Muslim countries. They lived in North Africa. They lived in the Middle East, among us, neighbors to us. In my country, till today, there are graves for Jews. Till today, they are protected. We protect their graves, let alone their homes, let alone if they lived among us. We've never persecuted any minority. Muslims ruled India for more than 800 years. And they did not try to exterminate the Hindu religion. The Hindus survived under the Muslim rule. Their temples survived under the Muslim rule. Why do they want to rewrite history? Why do they want to confuse? It's a media war. It's purposely done. They know very well history. They know very well who we are. We are the true religion that protects human rights, that protects minorities. Christians celebrate and do their prayers in their churches in all Muslim countries, even in Kuwait. They have churches in a very prime position in Kuwait City. And they go to their religion and they are protected. Everywhere we protect Christians. The Akhbat, my dear brother, the Christians of Egypt. Wasn't Egypt Muslim for as long as you remember? And the Akhbar, the Christians, those who choose to remain Christian, they still live in Egypt. That's our faith. And it is not a law that we can change overnight. In some of these countries, they have a law which prohibits discrimination, prohibits targeting people of other faiths and religion. But that law, they can change it overnight. For security reason, they may say, look, the situation has changed. But we Muslims, we will never change Allah's law because it is in the Quran al-Kareem. It is faith to us to protect others, to defend others, to give them the choice to be what they want to be. This is Islam. And it is sad to see that those Jews who lived among us, we protected them for centuries. One New York journalist, he said, they were telling him, why are you now talking against the Arabs and Muslims? And he said, look, I know for a fact that had the Jews of Europe in the time of Hitler been under Muslim rule, we would have had 5 million Jews today extra. He was admitting that it was Europe that killed the Jews and it was Muslims who protected the Jews. Why the Jews are killing our brothers and sisters in Palestine? Wallahi, I think they are deviant, they are, what can I say? They gave a tough, going to Musa alayhi salam, they've always, broke the promise and the treaties of Allah, and it seems they are ungrateful to our kindness. But do you think if we have the upper hand in Palestine, do you think that the Muslims will kill the Jews? No way, we would never do that. Do you know that, my dear brothers and sisters, the sacred church for Christians in Jerusalem, do you know who has the key to it, who keeps it safe? Because the Christians could not agree to whom to trust with the keys to this church. It's a Muslim family. A Muslim family is the one who keeps the keys to the Christian church. Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu, when he came to Jerusalem, he said, Muslims do not pray in churches. Do not pray in synagogues. Build your own mosques. Because if you pray in them, maybe some people who came after you, they will reclaim these churches to them and they will turn it into mosques. Allahu Akbar. And Umar ibn Khattab had the upper hand. He took over Palestine. He was the dominant power in his time. Nobody could ever challenge them. The Romans could not have challenged the Muslims. We defeated the Persian Empire and the Roman Empire. We were the only dominant state. There were wealth, there were human rights, people lived in peace and free to choose their religion. What did the world see since the Second World War today? Instability, coup d'etats. Do you think that only Muslims suffered, my dear brothers? The countries of South America, ask the people of Argentina, or Brazil, or Chile, how many coup d'etats they've suffered, how many military rules have killed from many of their people. Who helped these military juntas to take power? Who arranged a coup in Indonesia in the 60s against the Jama'a al-Islamiyya? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect Islam and Muslims, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our youth and our girls. My dear brothers, I have no doubt truth will prevail, and it's a difficult time, but it will pass. Even if you think we are hopeless today, but never lose hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is there, and He has the better of the plan. The enemies of Islam, they conspire, but Allah has the best plan. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولينا فيمن توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت اللهم لا تدع لنا ذنبا الا غفرته ولا دينا الا قضيته ولا هما الا فرجته ولا مريضا الا شفيته اللهم انصر الاسلام والمسلمين اللهم انصر الاسلام والمسلمين اللهم وحد صفوفنا واجمع كلمتنا يا رب العالمين اللهم فرج عن اخواننا المظلومين اللهم فرج عن اخواننا المظلومين يا رب العالمين اللهم ارفع البؤس عنهم اللهم انتقم من أعدائهم يا رب العالمين عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقم الصلاة